A very warm welcome to Bridge to India's virtual conference on India Corporate Renewable Market. Renewable power penetration for the C&I segment stands at merely 7% today, with an increasing number of green mandates intent to reduce emissions and cut down power production costs. The corporate renewable market is poised to be pivotal in India's renewable growth trajectory. Our two-day conference will address both challenges and opportunities for the C&I renewable segment and discuss its growth outlook. To discuss and deliberate on its pressing issues, we have curated 10 pertinent sessions with stakeholders from across the spectrum, including C&I consumers, developers, equipment suppliers, regulators, financiers, and investors. Before we begin with the conference, we want to take this opportunity to thank WWF India and the Ready Initiative, our strategic partners for this event, for their support. We also want to thank all our sponsors for their contribution in making this event possible. Our platinum sponsor for the conference is Nongi. Gold sponsors are Tata Power, Jinko Solar, and Radiance Renewables. You can visit their stalls in our exhibition hall to check out their products and offerings. We also want to thank our industry partners, National Solar Energy Federation of India, Indian Wind Power Association, IMSME of India, and Indo-German Energy Forum for their support. We will now begin with the conference with a brief welcome address by Mr. Vinay Rustagi, Managing Director, Bridge to India, and Ms. Vidya Sondarajan, Director, Ecological Footprint, WWF India. Vinay and Vidya will also set the tone for the conference with a brief sector overview. Over to you, Vinay.
Thank you, Ankita. And a very warm welcome to all the attendees of this conference. This is our Bridge to India's first full conference, and the reason we are doing it, there is no dearth of conferences in the market. There are many conference organizers, but we believe that we have something special and extra to offer. We hope to deliver quality content, leading industry stakeholders, in engaging discussions over the next 2 days. But now, we ourselves have been doing a lot of work in the C&I renewable market. As it happens, we currently have about 4 consulting engagements which are going on. We also are very, very active on the research side. So we hope that we can bring you the latest insights and developments in this market. So I will now share my screen and make a small presentation to hopefully set the stage for the next 2 days. So I hope you can see the screen. Now, renewables in the C&I space really started about 2014, around 2014-15. Those were the early days. Most consumers were basically interested in making a financial saving, which was the main driver. Since then, as Ankita said, the rush of consumers has actually turned into, I would say, not just a flood, but a tsunami. And the reason is that corporates are under increasing pressure to decarbonize and achieve net zero over the next few decades. Most of the leading corporates are not only adopting targets like 100% renewable power or net zero, but they're also forcing their suppliers, their entire supply chains to do so. So this really is a major rush now, not just to save money, but actually to reduce carbon emissions and help the fight against climate change. All said and done, the reality is that despite that, the share of direct procurement of renewables is still only about 7%. And that basically shows the opportunity that we have in front of us, the growth potential that we have for this market over the next few years. Now, not only is there a very strong interest from the consumers, the good thing is that there is also a very, very strong interest from the investors. Many of the startups in the C&I space, you know, companies like Radiance, Amplus, CleanTech, CleanMax, etc., have scaled up and they have become mature players with huge amount of technical and operational experience there have been some of the world's leading investors have entered into the market, and financing has almost become like an enabler and one of the strengths of this market. If I just take a few names, some of the leading investors who have come into this market, and that's companies like Shell, SHV Energy, which is a European gas company, Petronas, KKR, International Finance Corporation, TPG, so on and so forth, Northfund, so on and so forth. So there is no dearth of capital. In fact, the investors are itching to scale up and grow faster than they possibly can today. Now, there is a saying in Hindi, which is basically, jab dulha dulhan raji to kya karega kazi? And basically what that means is, if the bride and groom are ready, the consumer and the investor, then there is no role for any third party. But unfortunately, in this case, there is. There is a role for the power markets. There is a role for the DISCOM. There is a role for the state governments and the regulators. Unfortunately, that role is presenting various hiccups for the market. Consumers don't have all the options available to them in other countries. And in India, as it happens, at present, in the name, at least, there are these four routes available for procurement of power. So that is open access, rooftop solar, RECs, and the green power exchange. Now, all these four routes have huge limitations. In fact, REC trading has been suspended for more than 2 years now. Open access is not allowed almost completely, despite it being provisioned so in the Electricity Act. There are, at any given point of time, only about five or six states that freely permit open access power. There is no provision for interstate open access power. Similarly, when you come to green power exchange, although now we have more than 1 year of track record, the volumes are very tiny, and that's because there is no merchant capacity. And most of that trading volume is actually accounted for by the DISCOMs. So the role of CNI consumers and the power that they can buy on the exchange is still very, very limited. In a nutshell, the routes and the opportunities available to the consumers for buying renewable power are very, very few. Currently mainly limited to intrastate open access and rooftop solar. And those two are also not without their share of challenges. One of the biggest problems, of course, is the policy landscape. And I think, there are any number of problems and issues in the policy landscape, but all of them basically emanate from the fact that we have an inverted grid tariff structure in the country. Unlike most countries in the West, the CNI consumers cross-subsidize other consumers, and the distribution companies can't easily let go of these consumers without making a loss. And that presents many of these problems, which basically manifest themselves in many different ways. Sometimes consumers and project developers simply can't get project approvals. Sometimes policies are directly in conflict with each other. A clear example is states not recognizing the group captive concept. And in such cases, as it happens in Gujarat recently, the developers have to go to the court to get a consistent policy clarity. Sometimes the DISCOMs apply charges which have actually been waived on paper. Not just that, there are retrospective changes in policy sometimes. There are frequent changes to open access and net metering policy changes. There are charges which are being levied, incentives being withdrawn. So there are all kinds of challenges. And to be fair, the industry is not asking for incentives anymore. The industry is saying we need more clarity, whatever the charges are, whatever the project approval status is, please lay it out in front of us. And as long as the roadmap is cleared, we can understand that and we can plan our businesses accordingly. So the biggest issue in my view is actually the unpredictability of the policy. And that is why you see the word unpredictable, which is underlined. It's not that this industry is asking for incentives or waiver of charges, which are simply not available. Right? So the bottom line is, you know, I said there is a lot of demand, there is a lot of supply interest, the technology is there, but the bottom line is that the industry volumes are still very, very tiny. And as you can see in this slide, in both open access and rooftop solar, the market has been basically stagnating. Volumes have gone up, but they've also gone down. And by and large, we are pretty much at the same place today where we were about last 2 or 3 years ago in terms of the annual capacity addition in the sector. So, which is only about 2,000 megawatts. These are all CNI volumes. So we're only doing about 2,000 odd megawatts. The total installed capacity is about 18,000 megawatts in the CNI space. And we estimate the total potential across the CNI landscape to be about 130,000 megawatts in the next 9 years. That is assuming there are no policy hurdles or blockages in this market. Now, that basically shows you we are at 2 gigawatt per annum of new capacity today. We could easily go up to 10 gigawatts, 15 gigawatts to fulfill this kind of potential. The pleasing thing, of course, is that the government has belatedly, particularly at the central government level, started recognizing the potential of this market. There are new draft rules out from Ministry of Power. And while those rules are still in consultation stages, those rules are not binding upon the states, which will have the primary responsibility of framing their own policies with approval by the respective state regulators. We do hope that these Ministry of Power rules will provide some clarity, some guidance to the state, and some anchoring of state policies around some core principles in this business. Now, this is a slide which is actually a favorite of mine. What we are trying to show in this slide is the bottom bar chart basically shows what is the total CNI consumption across different states and how is that power demand being met from various routes. So, and those routes are basically the commercial and industrial demand from the DISCOMs, the captive conventional power, and the open access conventional power. Now, on the top, we are showing what is the size of the CNI installed base in these states. So, you know, you can clearly see there's a huge disconnect in what is happening in across in different states. Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Andhra Pradesh are some of the most advanced markets. But, you know, our view is that these markets are getting saturated. Andhra Pradesh almost closed the window about more than a year ago. And we believe there's a risk that Tamil Nadu and Karnataka might also do that in the coming, you know, year or so. But then the good thing is that there are other states like Gujarat, Maharashtra, Rajasthan, Punjab, Chhattisgarh, etc., Uttar Pradesh, where there is huge demand and very, very low penetration as things stand right now. The pleasing thing on top of that is that some of these states have started opening up the market. So we do expect Gujarat, Maharashtra, and Uttar Pradesh in particular to take the lead over the next few years. With Chhattisgarh, Haryana, and Punjab also hopefully following in their wake. So there are some challenges in a few states, but then of course there are lots of opportunities also in other states. In some, India is actually not one homogeneous market. India is actually a sum of 30 different markets, and that is how the industry has been growing. You know, two states close, but then there are five other states open. And we hope that more such states will be opening up than closing over the next few years. Now, the other unique thing about this market is that, you know, I said we are still in very early stages of the growth. Market has been predominantly based around rooftop solar and either plain vanilla open access wind or plain vanilla open access solar. But then there are many new technologies and opportunities available, not just in terms of procurement routes, but you know, technologies available to the consumers. And these technologies will enable consumers to actually go beyond the 10 or 20% or 30% gap that they typically face with the conventional procurement rules. So there is a wind solar hybrid, which has already started growing in a few states, Gujarat and Karnataka being the most prominent. But we do expect that with more states announcing favorable policies, this route will become much more popular with consumers. And it really allows consumers to go beyond, say, a 30% procurement ceiling in practice to as high as 50 to 60%. There is electrification underway in the corporate sector, you know, we expect more electrification, more renewable energy will help the net zero roadmap. There is renewable heat, you know, a very heavily neglected area because all the focus right now is on power, but there are very viable, attractive, proven technologies for renewable heat and process solutions, which we believe will grow over the years as awareness develops, as the ecosystem develops. And tomorrow we will have a session on this. How do you go beyond renewable power only? What are the other technologies available to consumers? There are companies which are also beginning to get into energy management. And then, of course, we have storage and hydrogen, the two big hopes of future. Both still in very nascent stages, partly because of very high cost, you know, lack of infra when it comes to hydrogen. But these are the two main technologies which are expected to play a very dominant role. And we will have a session on storage, behind the meter storage solutions and applications in the conference tomorrow. Just coming to, you know, what we have been doing in the sector. So as Bridge to India, we've been very active in the space. As you can see, we work with clients all across the sector, you know, right from policymakers, governments, regulators, think tanks, like WWF Ready program, which is, you know, where we've been acting as a technical partner for a better part of 2 years. But then we work with developers, investors, equipment suppliers, and consumers as well. And this slide is just a very small representation of some of the work that we have been doing lately. You know, these are all leading players in the industry. Most of the leading developers and many of the increasingly consumers are our clients. And as you can see, the work that we do is very varied. We have recently advised two consumers on, you know, how to go about building an RE procurement roadmap. How do you analyze the policy and market landscape, identify low-hanging fruit out there in terms of procurement routes and other opportunities, etc. We have advised many developers and contractors on the business strategy. And then also a lot of work in the last 2 to 3 years on M&A, buy-side advisory, basically screening and identifying investment opportunities, taking out, carrying out due diligence, validating business plans, so on and so forth. And then we have a thriving research business. In the research business, we now, you know, I think it is a proof that this market has become so mature and has got such great growth prospects. We now have a standalone dedicated product, which is India Corporate Renewable Brief. This is a new report we launched recently. It's a quarterly report available only on a subscription basis. But basically every quarter we round up and scan and give you an update on what is happening in this market, what is the capacity addition, who are the leading players, what are the projects, which state, what size, et cetera, which are being set up, what is happening on policy side, financing side, et cetera. And then we have various other reports which we have worked on over the years. And we continue to be very active on in terms of preparing deep market papers, research notes, etc. With that, I just come to the end of my presentation. I just want to also quickly showcase one of our research products, which is India RE Navigator, which is one of its kind a very unique market intelligence portal, giving you all the data 24/7 on the sector. Please do go and have a look at it. Most of the leading players in the industry are now subscribers to RE Navigator. If you are interested, we're very happy to give you a demo and answer any queries. That is the end of my presentation. I really enjoyed talking to you. I will be talking to you again during the course of the day. For now, I'm happy to pass over to Vidya Sangarajan. Vidya, over to you.
Thank you very much, Vinay, and Bridge to India. I'm very pleased to be able to speak to all of you in this very interesting corporate renewable energy market conference. WWF India, as you know, is a conservation nature protection organization. But however, as you know, my title suggests, we are also equally worried about the footprint, the human footprint that it has on the natural resources and ecology. So, you know, it's very natural to assume that moving away from conventional power and focusing a lot more on renewable energy takes center stage in our work. You know, the latest IPCC report has also highlighted that we may actually, you know, cross the threshold of 1.5 degrees in the next couple of decades. And so a big chunk of what, how we stop that movement is through renewable energy and moving away from conventional power. India on its on that pathway has actually announced really ambitious targets and has set huge targets for itself. You're all aware, I don't have to talk about the 450 gigawatt target that we have or the 175 gigawatt by 2022. What really pleases me, and I'm sure all of you, and I'm very grateful to the corporate customers, you know, CNI, in spite of all the challenges that Vinay just spoke about, and you're all probably aware already, we've still crossed the 100 gigawatt mark, and that's a hugely, you know, happy place to be in. And WWF India has been, as I said, has had a long focus on renewable energy and addressing climate change. And so we started an initiative called READY in 2018, which again, many of you are aware of. With a target of basically building the capacity, creating collaborative platforms, working towards innovation, identifying opportunities, and we have set a target for ourselves. Might seem minuscule in the bigger picture, but for us, it's a big target and a starting point to at least achieve 10 gigawatt of uptake by CNI customers. On the CNI customers, you're all aware that what an important role the corporate sector plays in this whole renewable energy matrix. You know, 51% of all our power consumption, electricity consumption in India is owing to the corporate sector. And obviously, we are on a development pathway, so it's essential. However, only 7% of that is actually renewable energy, which then means there is obviously a huge opportunity to expand. And especially, you know, many studies reveal that in the following decade, the demand for electricity overall is going to increase by over 65-68%. And that's a huge percentage, which a huge gap which we need to bridge. And so Bridge to India is rightly named, and I'm you know, it's very gratifying to know that. So we have to do that collectively. And I'm also, you know, it will be amiss if we don't mention that MNRE has actually, Ministry of Renewable Energy has actually taken a very strong stand and has been very supportive of the many actors that, you know, that go on consultation and bring about the challenges. And so they are very open and consultative. And one such example where we are very grateful is several of our sort of recommendations from a study the WWF came out about a couple of years ago on the renewable energy procurement, a buyer's perspective, have actually been included in the new guidelines that came out in August 2021. You know, already there has been a strong partnership with MNRE for our Ready program, and again, which is something that I'm as WWF India, representing WWF India, extremely pleased about. The green tariff, which you all know, is also another such policy initiative by MNRE, which is a great leap forward, which we are very hopeful that will actually add momentum to the uptake of renewable energy. You know, offers that kind of incentive matrix that Vinay was earlier talking about. That, you know, while there is a lot of active participation, interest and appetite from the CNI sector, I think such incentives really act as a catalyst for a big boom of uptake in renewable energy. You know, as I said earlier, in the one of our core focus as part of our Ready program is also to be able to consolidate a lot of information and build the capacity of the CNI industry. Once you understand and internalize, obviously there is a enhanced opportunity for procurement and uptake. In this, we have partnered with you know, Imperial College of London and CII, Confederation of Indian Industries. And we've been running capacity building courses for sort of senior to mid-level executives from the CNI group. And we've had, we've done a couple of sessions now, and we've had a overwhelming sort of uptake of that. And we're really hopeful that moving forward, that'll be one of the Ready initiatives, you know, qualitative sort of contribution to this whole pathway that India is taking towards renewable energy. Just to sort of close, I would really like to thank the CNI customers. We've had great interest shown by many of them, several of them, towards being member, you know, joining the Ready initiative and really supporting us in the process. We've had 30 plus corporates join, and that's a big achievement for us. And thank you to all the CNI customers. While I am on the even though it's a welcome sort of position from WWF, we are very grateful that we are able to, that the corporate sector is able to move India towards a greater contribution on climate, towards mitigating climate change, you know, support government of India achieve its targets, you know, add prestige, add that accolade to India in the international fora that we have actually gone ahead and achieved. So so hurrah to all of the corporate customers, and as an environmental organization, we are quite grateful that, you know, we are able to engage, and we are, you know, we see such a positive response. On that note, I think I'm sure we'll have the Joint Secretary Amitesh Kumar Sinhaji joining in sometime, and we have to really thank him for his leadership and being able to steer MNRE, you know, and grateful to the ministry as well as to the you know, the other joint secretary. So I think I'm running out of time. I should close now, but a big thanks to Bridge to India, a big thanks to Vinay's leadership, and the sort of convening and the qualitative analysis and the insight into the industry that they bring. I think it plays a huge role, and we must acknowledge the huge role they've played in, again, achieving India's big targets. So I welcome you all to this conference, and I'm really hopeful that it offers the, you know, planned sort of momentum and and a catalytic recharge to the whole uptake process. And I'm very happy to see this happening in the run-up to COP26, which is going to be a crucial COP. And, you know, we are really hoping private sector, public sector, individual actors, civil society, the consumers, all, you know, up their game and all really make this strong move towards mitigating climate change. So on that note, I welcome you all, and I really look forward to learning. I really look forward to engaging through the next couple of days. So thank you very much, and over to you, Ankita. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, Vidya, thank you very much. I think that really sets the stage nicely for us to go forward. But I must say, you know, huge thank you. Thanks to WWF as well. I know the team is very, very passionate, and there's a huge role for think tanks and independent entities like WWF to play a part in the sector. And I know that because we've been working very closely with your team and fantastic, highly committed individuals.
Exactly. And thank you for saying that. I will accept the on behalf of team the congratulations very greatly, but I'll also add extremely passionate, committed, dedicated team. You know, even within a conservation organization, to establish that we have to start looking at renewable energy, and this is a priority area for us. You know, as you all know, changing your own house is far more difficult than changing the world. So I think the team has very successfully done that. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you, Vidya. Thank you. Just moving on, we are grateful to have with us Mr. Amitesh Kumar Sinha, who is the Joint Secretary in MNRE. Amitesh ji, very warm welcome. And thank you so much for your time. We just started the session half an hour ago. We made an opening presentation about the market snapshot and status. And I think the industry would hear to love from you. Just to kind of, you know, before I give it to you, I think the industry today feels like it is a caged tiger. I think the tiger is just bursting to free itself and run. There is so much demand from both consumers as well as the investors. But then I think we also know what are all the various issues. And in that note, in that regard, Ministry of Power's recent guidance, the draft note issued on draft open access rules is very, very helpful. The challenges are there are not too many procurement routes open to the consumers. There is too much policy uncertainty. The DISCOMs don't want to lose their customers. Sometimes they don't give project approvals. Sometimes they levy charges which are not supposed to be levied, etc., etc. So we all look forward to hearing from you in terms of how MNRE sees this market. How do you think this market can be supported and can grow into you know, and realize its potential, which we estimate at 130 gigawatts in the next 9 years. Amitesh ji, very warm welcome to you.
Thank you, Vinay ji. We all know that RE sector is booming, and we have all huge responsibility towards the climate change. And in that direction, India is working, and we are on track to achieve the sub 2 degree C level, which we are all committed. India is only a major economy or G20 economy. And we are not only meeting our NDC target, but we are also will be able to surpass that those targets with a great margin. You know that the target of renewable energy is 450 gigawatts, and it has broadly four or five big elements. One is utility scale RE, and second is corporate sector, then third is distributed RE through rooftop and through farm activities. And then there are miscellaneous other activity. Recently, we have added hydrogen also. So hydrogen will also augment the capacity addition of renewable energy. So there is a huge market, and 450 gigawatt itself gives the opportunity and hope to everybody, either from developer side, there is a assured demand, And from consumer side, everybody is willing to be look 100% green, and there is a less opportunity for them to do so. So now this draft open access draft rules which has come out to facilitate open access as well as other forms will be able to meet the consumers' demand or desire to become 100% green. So, you know, after a lot of discussion, this open access rules were formulated, and it is in discussion stage. Everybody is giving comments. Most we are very hopeful that very soon it will be finalized. It has various segments. If you want to use green energy yourself, then there is a captive power plant. If you want to do it partially, then do it a certain percentage at your level and buy from DISCOM. DISCOM will provide you a green tariff and green energy. They will give you a certificate. So you can meet by using both options also. You can add up through open access also, do something at your level, buy something at DISCOM level, open access level, and then the rest of that you can take from DISCOM. So all sorts of combination, permutation and combination is now possible. And we are here to facilitate everything. The most difficult thing is getting a renewable energy through open access. There are a lot of charges, and after paying all those charges also there's difficulty in getting open access approval. So, you know, it is already very clearly written that there will be a central portal and all agencies will be asked to clear those proposals within 15 days. So once these approvals are in place, I don't think anybody will be able to stop renewable energy, because it is cheap also, and it is a desire of consumers that I want to use green energy. So from both sides, it will happen. And Ministry of New and Renewable Energy as well as Ministry of Power, we both are here to facilitate any form of renewable energy. And I want to assure you that both the ministry are in tandem, and we are working tirelessly to facilitate such kind of thing. You know, hydrogen has also recently been added. So if somebody is, some consumer wants to abate carbon emission from their sectors where it is very difficult in the form of energy, they can use hydrogen also. And 1 megawatt hour equivalent of renewable energy will be considered if it is used for production of hydrogen or green ammonia. So that option is also available for industry sectors. Right now it is costly. We have seen that very soon it will be economical for refinery and fertilizer sector. And in future, probably the steel and heavy mobility will be the biggest two sectors where you will see a lot of hydrogen activity. So this will open up a big opportunity for renewable energy capacity addition. And we are estimating that at least 100 gigawatt will come through hydrogen route until 2030. So we are working on a national green hydrogen mission document that will be rolled out in next 3 to 4 months after taking approval of the cabinet. Banking is another facility which is very much required. If you are trying to meet your 100% RE requirement, either through captive or plus open access plus DISCOM, if you want to do everything, then you may be falling short of a few percentage of renewable energy, particularly when you are eyeing open access or captive. So in that case also, this banking facility has been provided, and there will be a charge, of course, for banking facility. And to support genuine customers, it was felt that 10% of annual energy consumption will be sufficient to meet requirement of a consumer if he wants to exhaust all possible means, and that is solar plant, wind plant, or battery, or any combination of anything with that. From supply side, RE developers have a big opportunity. Either they can directly enter into a contract with open access consumers, or they can sell energy in the market also. So we are working for deepening of the market, and you are seeing that gradually the energy sell and purchase through exchange is increasing every year, and there will be new markets will be introduced very shortly. So this will give opportunity to all developers either to directly enter into agreement or or to target general consumers through exchange. So all these things are there. As far as finance is concerned, we are seeing a lot of interest from many financial institutions, Indian and abroad. All big financial institutions are in India and they're looking for the opportunity. Overall, the mood is very upbeat and everybody wants to use renewable energy. We are seeing it very clearly. Only the role of government is to facilitate that. We think that RPO is a very, very powerful tool to do that. And amendments are in, we are working for amendments. Hopefully it will be through. Particularly for RPO, it will be cleared very soon, as we hope. And apart from RPO, there is a provision for penalty also. So this RPO and penalty will probably help utility scale projects more. But the energy purchase obligation, which is on all consumers, there also they will try to buy power as early as possible. So I think we all have to work together. There is a COP26 meeting in November in Glasgow, and everybody is looking towards India, whether what kind of announcement we are going to make there. The pressure is on, and we are very, we are in a comfortable state that we are doing our duty, and hopefully we'll do so with more vigor in future also. I want to wish every Indian citizen, and I want to take their help to fight against this energy transition. Hopefully we'll be the world leader in doing that. And there is a tremendous responsibility on our shoulder as a officer or as a developer or as a consumer or as a citizen to fulfill the wishes of entire global mass. With that, Vinayji, I would like to complete my share. Thank you.
Thank you, Amitesh. Thank you. Those are very, very encouraging words. And I think the industry is obviously very appreciative of all the MNRE efforts in making this happen. Vidya, do you have any questions or any reactions in response to Amitesh Ji's remarks?
Thank you, Vinay, and thank you very much, Amitesh Ji, and also MNRE. I don't have many questions. I just wanted to say that you know, we are, as I said, we are very grateful, and I'm really looking forward to you know, the new incentives, initiatives, the you know, sort of new introduction of guidelines around RPOs to actually facilitate and encourage more corporate customers to take up renewable energy. Aside of that, I think you know, we have in multiple sort of studies, and of course a lot of other you know, research and think tanks have also collated, and government itself has done a research. Some of the regulations and some of the more, you know, a combination of incentive, punitive measures, you know, will still need to be strengthened. I don't have to say that you've mentioned it already, that you're working towards it. Thank you. And I think we really look forward to working and being able to be of any service support towards our journey to achieving the renewable energy targets. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vidya. So, Amitesh Ji, I had a few questions. I hope you have some time.
Yes.
So, the first question I had was, what is the status of these rules? What is the next step, and how do you think, by when do you think the final set of rules can be issued?
So right now it is for stakeholders consultation, and everybody is giving reply. We are also receiving various suggestions. It will be collated, and it will be improved further on the basis of comments. Then it will be concluded. I think it will take around 1 to 2 months in the time period. Then we'll approach Law Ministry also to vet that.
So do you think by the end of the year, is it realistic to expect the final rules?
Yes.
And the next question I had was, the biggest problem, of course, is that the DISCOMs are naturally fearful of losing this business. How do you make sure that the DISCOMs and the states accept this new framework and openly adopt it and start helping the market in this direction?
So there are three things of to address this issue. One is RPO. So if RPO is there, everybody would like to promote this particular segment because it will add to their RPO obligation. Second is that the demand is stagnant right now because of COVID and other activities for last 2 years. So once demand will start increasing, so there will be a need to buy extra energy from DISCOM side also. And then probably it will not hamper their interest much. Of course, the original customers who are paying a tariff of 8 rupees, 10 rupees, 12 rupees is likely to go outside their purview. But there will be many new requirements. There will be very new energy demands from industry coming. And probably this will not impact that much as we are anticipating. And largely, everybody has understood that this is going to happen. Energy transition is going to happen, and nobody can stop this exercise. With the help of these rules, probably they will be also working towards reorienting their working. You know, renewable energy cost has come down, and there are various means to now get round the clock power also by adopting different storage facility, and going ahead it will be cheaper and it will be more economical and commercial in all sense. So DISCOM will try to adopt with this new normal. And you will see that very soon some DISCOMs will start leading the show, and they will come out with innovative models. Ultimately, they have to buy power and they have to sell power. So once a model is perfected, where they are not losing at their end, I don't think there is a problem. So, but this is a challenge, and we have yet to see how DISCOMs are going to address this issue. We are ready to support them. You know, there are a lot of packages announced, and the last package of 3,000 crore is also available for them. A lot of modernization is happening at DISCOM level also. Prepaid meters are, smart meters are under installation. And probably that will also help DISCOMs to minimize their losses on that front. So it will open up a new opportunity and new working system in DISCOMs also. They will address this issue and themselves.
Okay. No, thank you. That makes a lot of sense. I don't want to talk about the various aspects of the draft rules, because I know that you're getting a lot of feedback and they will ultimately change. But one more question I had was, when solar was very expensive, let's say 5, 6, 7 years ago, the government did offer a lot of incentives to the C&I market. There were capital subsidies available even for C&I projects. There were tax benefits. And there was also like a concessional debt financing scheme. Now, all that is not needed for solar and wind, but it is still needed, in my view at least, for new technologies like storage and hydrogen, etc. And I mean, I don't see anything happening in that direction. And in fact, we do see there's a lot of interest in storage technology, for example, for all kinds of CNI applications. But the issue always comes back to is, it is still too expensive. We will wait another 2 years or 3 years or 4 years. And my fear is that, you know, if we wait too long, there is a chicken and egg situation. The manufacturing ecosystem does not develop. The installation ecosystem does not develop. Is there any way the government can also think about at least offering some limited period incentives? We know that financing, you know, there are fiscal constraints, but at least some short duration incentives to kickstart some of these new technologies and new markets.
So, Vinayji, demand and supply is ultimately very helpful in lowering the cost. And we are seeing that the storage cost is coming down very fast. Now we are trying to create a demand for a storage by adopting various means. So one is, you know, innovative bids in the form of picking power and round the clock power, that is creating demand for storage. Then second, we are targeting grid level storage facility. You have recently heard Honorable Minister also that 4,000 megawatt hour and with bids will be floated, and then it will be increased to 13,000 megawatt hour. So those bids are also coming. So once these bids will be in public domain, it will create a demand. And you know, there is a PLI scheme for battery facility also. And probably when the large scale manufacturing of battery will start, it will help in reducing the cost. The third element in the form of storage is for stabilization of grid frequency and voltage management. So that will also be seen as an ancillary market. And then the last one is storage as a transmission planning. So when now we are planning transmission in Ladakh area, in Khavda area, where large scale transmission, RE transmission is required. And we have seen that if we halve the capacity of transmission line, suppose 10 gigawatt is required for Ladakh and we are planning for 5 gigawatt and we are adding battery, the cost of 5 gigawatt of transmission line plus battery is lower than laying 10 gigawatt transmission line. And this 5 gigawatt transmission line will be able to carry 9 gigawatt of solar and 3 gigawatt of wind. So we have calculated like that. So such kind of measures also we are taking. So all these measures will create demand. And we expect that the cost of battery in India will come down very fast. For the time being, as you are saying that some incentive in any form is required. So we will be coming out with a storage policy, and we would like to see if there any financing is required from our side or not, because we think that it will be competitive and there will be a professional storage provider also. So rules are under development. We are working on that. And the independent storage facility will also will come in the market. They will have their own rates. And probably if we see that they are able to sell stored power without any additional financial burden, then there will be no sense of providing any kind of subsidy. Our financial support, yes, we will work with the various organizations to provide financing in case they will feel difficulty. But I think storage will not require any subsidy at this present moment. If we sense that, we will do that also.
Okay, thank you, Amitesh. So just a quick request to all the delegates. If you want to ask Amitesh any questions, please do mention those questions in the chat box, and we will take those up. So Amitesh, any word on the REC reforms program, because that is one route which is very, very popular in other countries, but in India obviously the trading has been suspended for more than 2 years, and I think one of the key attractions of the REC route is that it really does allow consumers to go beyond 30 to 40% or 50% RE without worrying too much about things like banking and transmission charges, et cetera, et cetera. And then, of course, it's a short-term measure. So any short-term mismatches, REC is the best route rather than tying up into long-term PPAs. So any word on the REC scheme?
So REC, we are working with the Ministry of Power also to revive this REC trading very shortly. And apart from that, there is a bigger market which is under development. So right now, REC is only for renewable energy or power sector. And there are a lot of emissions happening in other industrial applications. So probably you will see that there will be a parity. There will be a kind of matching of both sectors, REC as well as emission certificates. There will be equivalent that will be worked out. And a Indian market will be evolved, which will integrate everything together. You will also see that some multiplier is offered for new technologies like offshore, hydrogen, and any things if required with the combination of the storage also. But there will be a multiplier in REC also. Very, very soon you will see a new draft coming for a stakeholder consultation on that also. We are working on that.
So, Amitesh, can I clarify that? I mean, that's a very big announcement, and at least I wasn't aware of it. You were saying that the REC scheme will be turned into some kind of a composite emissions scheme, encompassing all kinds of emission reduction technologies?
Yeah, so actually the work has started, and we cannot consider it as an announcement, but because in what form it will come, we don't know. But emission certificates are there, and they are being sold separately. REC is there, and we are trading it separately. So there is a need to combine everything together and to develop a common market, a common platform for selling and purchase of these certificates. So probably a new mechanism will be worked out. Very soon you will be seeing a new kind of thing for stakeholders coming.
Okay, I think that's fantastic news. I appreciate that there's no formal announcement yet, but I think that is the right direction in which we ought to move forward. So Miteshji, thank you so much for your time again. I think it's wonderful interacting with you as always. I think we are very fortunate to have such a committed MNRE you know, people like you who are always very supportive hopefully helping taking the sector forward. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.